Okay, about and transformers, and you know, this is kind of the highlight of the machine learning technology today, especially since you know, the success of transformers in natural language processing became so prevalent with several models, pre-trained models, that had been published. So I will kind of talk about not so much a specific, although we'll get to music transformers, I will not talk so much about specific models because there are a lot of them today, like the GPT-2, 3, BERT. But kind of the motivation for transformers and the technique itself, I think is important to understand. And there's something not so trivial about why transformer is such a powerful tool. Also, in terms of kind of getting the motivation or the mathematical understanding of what transformer does, why it models so well, distributions of sequences. You know, if you kind of follow the chronological development, or you know, the first paper about transformer actually was called "Attention is All You Need." So kind of it grounds itself or builds the theory on attention. Another way to look at this is through kind of word embeddings, like word. Word to back, and there is a lecture on that that kind of gives a different perspective on embeddings that the transformers do. But since in the previous class we talked about RNNs, I think it's only natural kind of to extend the RNNs through attention and then address the transformer itself. So we'll talk first about the attention in RNN. So in the sequence-to-sequence approach to RNNs, we know that we have basically the inputs that are encoded, and then the latent states with the encoded sequence are passed from the past to a certain point where we start decoding this in the language translation, let's say model, I am a person. At a certain point, you know, we need to have some kind of token that tells us we'll start the translation to French, and then the decoding happens in this recursive way. So if we think about this approach to sequence-to-sequence modeling, what we have is basically some kind of a decaying importance of the past, because the same latent state that is being passed, or the latent state that is being passed from here to here to here, basically the effect or the influence of X1 in some sense is diminished. And while here, the final hidden state, this kind of thought vector that is being passed to the initiation of the generative part, the translation into French, basically encodes all of that sequence, and then based on that initial state and the first word here, they kind of like start reproducing the sequences. But there is the idea that everything is encoded on the English side first, and then from that encoding, everything is decoded on the French side. And that provides you know, pretty powerful model, but it also has some difficulties. So the idea of paper on attention, which is one of the references for transformers later on, introduced an additional attention mechanism at the stage of passing, or between the stage of passing the encoded states H to the decoded states S. So what we have is basically a sequence of encoded states and sequence of decoded states that both meet at the attention mechanism. And there is a single fully connected network that actually receives both the decoded states and the encoded states, and creates by a fully connected network a set of attentions, which are then multiplied again. And this act of multiplying the H with S to give us A's, which weight differently the H's again, to create another input sequence C1, C2, C3, C4, is kind of the core attention mechanism here. So what we actually have here? We have a set of encodings on the encoding side, and which are passed through a fully connected network. And we have the set of decodings, or the latent states of the decoder, which are passed or concatenated in a sequential way. And all are actually added together to create these weights. Okay, so what we have is these excitations that take the, basically if we look at, let's say one of the past encodings, so L minus one, or it's state L, we multiply this with H1, or concatenate it with H1, we concatenate this with H2, with H3 and H4. So each one of these states is actually presented as an input pair into a fully connected vector network, sorry. And this network eventually creates an activation function, or which results in using a softmax in these weights, A1, A2, AI1, AI2, AI3, AI4, because we have basically four past inputs that are now matched with an output at the time I. And this is what we see here. Each one of these latent states of the decoder is paired with one of the, all past latent states of the encoder, and they result in these weights A, alpha or A, alpha IJ, and then this weight is applied again to the latent states H to create a set of inputs. So what is the motivation for this mechanism? Why this was so successful that it was eventually replicated in full in the transformer, and just that mechanism was kept, and actually the recurrent neural network, the passing of the latent states from, you know, the previous time to the future time was abandoned, and just that multiplication was kept. So what we have is basically an alignment between each decoder state I, or I mean, just the way it's calculated, it's I minus one, but you can think about this, any state I and any encoder state J are aligned, and they result in attention weights, alpha IJ through softmax. So this, you know, this weighting is then applied again to the encoder states, all of them. So for state output state I, okay, we actually look at the alignment between state, which is one step back in time, and all of the previous encoding states. They create this weighting through the softmax mechanism, which are learned weights. So this alignment and the softmax matrix that creates the attention weights is actually part of the learning process, you know, in the end-to-end kind of fashion. And once we have them, these weights are used again to multiply the encoding latent states to create the C's, which are the context vectors. And this is fed into the decoder to generate the input. So what we have basically is an alignment. So here is a model or example of the meaning of these weights the alpha ij. What we have is English versus French paired sequences in the translation application. So what we have is kind of the, I'll read the text and how clear it is on, you know, on the screen. But basically what we have, an English sentence: the agreement of the European Economic Area was signed in August 1992, which during the framing process was matched with the French version, which is l'accord sur les zones économiques européennes a été signé à août 1992, okay? So we can see that a lot of the words could be basically matched and looked up in the dictionary. So there and the L and the agreement, the code. So the sentence kind of seems to flow matching word to word, which doesn't really maybe require so much time information. And that's kind of amazing that you can take this whole sentence and code it into a latent state and then expect from that latent state to decode all of these. But there's something particular about English versus French that the European Economic Area in English translates to a zone économique européenne. So the area is last in these three words, European Economic Area. And here's zone économique européenne. In English, the area is the last word. And in French, it's the first word, okay? Economic is the middle one, and then the European in English is the first, and in French is the last one. And we see this effect by seeing this line which goes in the opposite direction. So instead of the time flowing here, we see that we need to switch the order of the words. And in that case, what happens is that we can flip or understand that something about the importance of attending to the words in English cannot flow in one-to-one fashion or cannot flow in time and from left to right, but basically we need to kind of go all the way to area and in order to start producing the zone, then we kind of go back to economic and then we go to European. And here is kind of another example that you can kind of check on yourself. But maybe I'll just read it. It should be noted that the marine environment is the least known of environments. And in French, you convient de noter que l'environnement marine, environment marine, and here's maritime environment. So again, the environment and the marine switch, and you can see these effects here. So basically this alignment allowed to improve was this aspect of decaying time that the original RNN had. And the idea of matching or waiting in the sequence until we encode a few words, until we start translating, basically created these direct relations between input and output, which eventually superseded the whole idea of time just by matching words from the input to output by creating these kind of alignment matrices. Now, once this idea was applied to two languages, you could also think about applying this to the language itself and to improve the modeling aspect of a language. So if we think about being within a single language, the idea of attention became self-attention. So what is self-attention? So you can see that in order to understand a sentence in any language, and this is kind of an English example, we actually have to trace back some of the meaning of words in the future to words in the past, or maybe wait until the sentence ends, until we understand what the word means. So the animal didn't cross the street because it was too tired. So it, can refer to the animal, it can refer to the street, it can refer to any noun. So in that sense, once we start exploring relations between words in the same language, we kind of start understanding that the word "it" has to be decoded based on the encodings of the animal here, okay? And actually, animal didn't. You kind of need to wait for the animal didn't, so we know what is the subject, what is the verb, so that the "it" probably means this, although the street, you can see, is also kind of a little bit more orange than the rest. It was too tired. I don't know why kind of two becomes weighted more significantly, but basically the idea is that learning language can be done by looking into sequences and correlating them with themselves. Basically trying to see in structures that have time, also structures that jump or have more importance from a specific point in the sequence to the past and maybe to the future. So self-attention basically extends this idea of attention to a single sequence or the sequences within the same language, same information source. And the way it was introduced in the first Transformers paper was basically this diagram. And without going through all the steps before, this kind of looks as a prescription that is a little bit hard to understand what is the motivation. Of course, we can implement this. We have matrices. We have some kind of a network that does matrix multiplication. And there is a scaling. There is some mass that I'll talk about eventually, softmax. So this, this phase from this product of input, two inputs into a network that creates a softmax. And this softmax creates weights that then multiply another sequence. This is really kind of replication of the idea of the RNN attention, where the difference is that instead of looking here into the H and S, basically the latent states of the RNN encoder and the RNN decoder, here we call them query key and value vectors. And normally the query and the value are the same input. So if we recall the analogy to this case, okay? So we have the H and S. So S and H are input here to create the weights. And then these weights, alpha, multiply again H. So basically we have only two inputs, but in the transformer, we call them query key and value. And having these three inputs, query, key, and value, each one basically has a matrix that is being learned. And each key is paired with value. So this is kind of the H and the S, or the S and the H. This will be the H, the S paired together. Okay, this output, okay, is here, basically translated through softmax to convex combination of input value vectors. So here we have the H's again that multiplied by the output of this softmax. And the intermediate steps are exactly the same as in the attention. We have dot product of the query with the keys, and they create the attention weights, and they're normalized, and they multiplied. They multiply values by these weights. So this is really the core idea of attention that was borrowed from the RNN, or motivated by that idea of RNN, that basically highlighted this phenomena that in a sequence you do not necessarily encode time in a linear fashion, but you might want to look at all of the inputs and all of the output encodings and find these links or jumps or connections. We kind of seen the same effect when we looked into string compression and the factory oracle with the VMO. And also, of course, the encoding with LAMPL-Z, that we kind of encode sequences by looking for repetition in the past. So there is kind of this underlying phenomena and motivation in dealing with sequences that to understand something in time, you need to look not only back a certain amount of steps in time, the time arrow doesn't necessarily proceed from past to the future through some kind of a Markov or fixed block of encodings, but there could be really jumps, and the intermediate steps sometimes are irrelevant in order to decode the future event, because it is in some sense strongly influenced. Maybe it's a replication, maybe it's actually recopying of something that happened way back. So if we are able to kind of learn these networks, these jumps of words, this is where this matrix comes handy. So in the self-attention, basically what we have is, I'll kind of go step by step with this animation, we have the self-attention layer. So every input is actually translated into three query key and value representations. And we have this for each one of the inputs. Now, every query here, okay, is matched with all the keys, okay? So this is kind of the similar thing for the query, which is basically now we're talking about the same sequence, but still it's maybe it's easier to think about H and S because we started with RNN. So the S1 is multiplied with K1, with K2, with K3, K4, okay? And this creates the weight A1. This weight is now, this weight multiplies the input vectors V1, all of the values, okay? So query, key, and value. This weight is now basically looking and receiving all of the values to produce the output. In the next step, we have kind of the same effect. Sorry, let me go to this step. In the next step, we have the Q2, which receives information about K1, K2, K3, K4, and this produces the A2, which now is something that weighs the other values. So we can look at this in this more of a matrix multiplication way, where what we have is an encoding that goes through one network, gives us Q vectors, Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5. We have the keys, K1, K2, K3, K4, and K5. And they're multiplied basically element-wise. So Q1 will be multiplying, and the first element in Q1 will be multiplying all of the elements in the first. So this is the row, and these are the columns, but this product is basically taking every element in the encoding Q1 and multiplies this with all of the Ks to result in A1. So here's the Q times K transpose gives us the vectors of A's. And same thing in Q1, Q2 multiplied by all of the Ks will give us the vector of A2. Q3 with all of them gives us the A3. And this is passed through softmax to create basically the A's. These A's are then multiplied again by the V's. So what we get is the output which is the attention weights multiplying the values. So here is kind of this analogy between what happens in the RNN and what happens in the transformer. And once we kind of ignore this time arrow, and which is really what is the essence of RNN, and we just look at the encodings here at the latent states and the encodings S here, we can see that this attention mechanism becomes sort of a lookup that weighs differently what kinds of input values should be considered in order to decode into the output latent state, which then is decoded into the output sequence itself. So what we have is, as we said, we have the Q, which are the S's. We have the H, which is used twice, once as the key, and once the query and the key are multiplied and the resulting the weights through this expression. So basically we have some kind of a nonlinear, or we have a nonlinear function, which is implemented as a neural network. And this gives us the excitations, which are then passed through softmax. Once we have these alphas, they are multiplying again the H, the values, which are the encodings of the input, to give us basically this matrix multiplication that will result in the outputs. In some sense, the motivation is looking into relations between sequences over time, and this is not a new phenomenon. In music, the idea of self-similarity has been explored by multiple researchers. Maybe the most notable was kind of one of the early papers by Jonathan Food, who was not, he was not concerned with encoding, decoding, and any kind of a deeper statistical representation, but it was more a question of trying to analyze musical structure. So the idea is, if you look at music as a sequence, and of course you have to somehow tokenize or chunk it and represent this as either vectors or find some way of matching note by note between every note to the past notes. But you can see that there are a lot of repetitions, and basically what we have is, in his original paper, the time flows in up. So this is the time zero that goes up and to the right. So here the diagonal is actually going from the bottom to, from bottom left to top right. While in the RNN paper, we saw the time flowing just the other way. But you can see that, of course, the diagonal means that every note is similar to itself, but you can see that there are these kind of lines that emerge, which indicate that there are subsequences. So there was kind of a subsequence starting at times three that flows, moves forward, that that is similar to whatever happens from the beginning to, so between three and four, there's something that happens which is very, very much like the sequence that we saw from zero to two, okay, or zero to one. So these lines, I mean, all of these are kind of indications of repeated sequences, and we can basically read them by looking at what time on one of the axes matches another segment here. Okay, so of course the diagonal is time matching to itself, and here are kind of delays of repeated sequences. You can also see blocks. So these kinds of analysis where you take a sequence, and in the case of self-similarity, it's the same sequence. Of course, you need to encode it in some way. So this is why we have H and S and not the sequence directly. We learn these encodings. So this is where we actually have a neural network that actually encodes the queries and the keys. Then we do this outer product to create this self-similarity or attention matrix. And then this matrix is treated as excitation or activation. okay, through softmax to normalize this to be between 0 and 1. So it looks kind of grayscale from white, from black to white. And then this matrix is used to multiply again the same sequence. You can, we don't have the values here, but the values here will be a vector here that by matrix multiplication with this attention map will now weight differently every region. Okay, and this kind of shows that we have different levels of importance throughout the sequence to every element. So if we want to look at the music transformer now, and the original transform paper, of course, itself, which I didn't cover before, was the idea that we have, again, an encoder and a decoder. In the self-attention, we looked so far only at one element, but now when we use this to encode our input vector, we might want to train this also as language translation or some kind of sequence-to-sequence model. So the same process is done on the output embedding, with the difference is that when we do the decoding, we still need to kind of pass every element in the output to the next step to create the decoding. Sorry for the noise in the background. So what we get is the full transformer actually has an encoder and has a decoder. It also has another element, which is a positional encoding. And this positional encoding kind of gives us an extra index to include some aspect of time, because right now we just treat the whole vector as, you know, we could in some sense reshuffle all the weights or reshuffle the time and still create the same kind of attention. So if time is important, we have a positional encoding. And so the transform itself has both a source and target embeddings. You have encoder, decoder. You have the feed forward networks that actually, after we do the attention, okay, they add another layer that is input into the decoder. They have, there is a softmax at the output probabilities. And the additional layers, of course, we mentioned the normalization layer. We have the positional encoding. And one last thing is that the transformer suggested to have multiple attention maps because we can learn multiple matrices for query, key, and value encodings. So what is a positional encoding? Basically, we might want to have some sort of a index in time, which could be either relative. So each feature dimension is multiplied by some function like a sinusoid of different frequency that gives us an index for what is the position. And in the original paper, you have basically sine and cosine waves that are used just as indexes, as a deterministic function to give us the position. So position at a location k steps in the future is a linear function of position k steps back, given time and offset. So this kind of an additional vector is added to the encoded vector itself, just to treat time as kind of a template. And this kind of creates this expectation of something that will happen or has to be looked back certain amount of steps back in time, regardless of the sequence itself. And this type two informations and what word is being entered and when it happens is actually fed into the transformer. You have the learned positional embeddings they can be trained. So instead of using a fixed encoding, you can learn positional embeddings it performs pretty much the same as, not better as than the relative embeddings, but you can see in different papers, different implementations of this added positional embedding. So in the absolute position encoding, basically what we have is we have these indices that are added to the key, and they also produce an additional set of weights or attention weights. So in some sense, we just look at how things reappear over time as a function of the query, and then we add them together to create the output by multiplying with the value inputs. Now, masking. Masking happens in the decoder because when we start decoding or when we want to learn and want to start producing the output, we don't want to have all the source target tokens to be attended to. So this kind of introduces back this idea that still, I mean, there is something in time that flows from past to the future. And this is needed when we want to learn how to decode a sequence. So during training, we basically create sort of a shift or create a mask that we'll see in a second that shifts the target right or forward in time to avoid copying to the output, because otherwise, basically, there is no real way to learn how to decode. You know, we might also mask the source if a token doesn't depend on later tokens. So if it's important for us to generate strictly left to right, this might be applied both to the encoder and the decoder. I mean, one way to do this is before normalizing the tension weights, you add very infinite a negative weight to the mask position. So this forces both the softmax values to be zero. This is kind of like, I would say, tricks to create an encoding that moves from left to right. And what it allows us is kind of to create these, well, eliminate or create these maskings that instead of having every token in the past look into every token in the future, we only say that the, you know, K1 is looking only at the first element of Q1, K2 only attends to the first two elements in Q2, K3 can see the three elements of Q3, and so on. So each one of these sequences is basically only allowed to be tending to what happened before, but not into the future. So the multi-head attention is just repeating the same idea with multiple possible matrices that learn basically different V, K, and Q networks, and they're called attention heads, but basically these are copies. Well, they're not exact copies. You learn each one separately, but in terms of the architecture, it's the same architecture. And so each head learns different linear projection of query key and value, and it performs an attention in the same way. So in some sense, what we have is if the matrix that maps the input through the key and query and the value, if these are matrices that kind of embed or create a representation of the input and they capture a specific representation, specific type of feature, we actually allow multiple ways or multiple features to be extracted from the input sequence. We can have multiple mappings of the input. So we have multiple representations, and each representation will actually have its own type of attention. It kind of makes sense if you think about the idea that we might want to extract from the input sequence different aspects of the semantics or the meaning of that sequence. And based on that mapping, we might actually find relations between different elements in the sequence itself. If you think maybe about signals and this is one of the extensions of the transformers, not only languages, but also time series and inputs. You might think that you extract multiple features from that same sequence. So, and maybe in some analogy to the feature extraction that we have seen in previous lectures, where we analyze the sequence in terms of the Fourier analysis, but we can also have a lot of other features that are extracted from the same sequence. You can think about these multiple heads, each one learning a different representation before looking into the self-similarity or looking into the attention aspect. So each of the learned features will have its own attention map. So we have multiple attention maps, and then we concatenate them, and we basically have the final linear projection of the concatenation, which is presented to either the decoder or self-learning, so the output here. Now, how we use this to generate? So, we assume that, we have source and target sequences when we were learning, but at inference time, we only have access to a source. So there's several ways to kind of start decoding. Okay, one is you basically start with some kind of a null token like we do in the RNN, or we start with the primer sequence, and then we feed the output into the decoder again, very much like we did in the RNN. So if we remember how it looked, the decoding of the French sequence from the first slide. I don't want to scroll all the way up. It was, we knew that the output of the first step is actually input into the RNN as a way to generate the next word. So basically, this is kind of the same idea. That we start generating with something, either null or some primer sequence, and we feed it on itself until it stops generating. There are some other ways to do this. You can basically produce all of the output probabilities and randomly sample them and do a beam search. So for the generation purposes, there are several ways of taking the output and producing basically taking the last layer and from this producing the actual decoding. There are some links that I provided here, visualizing the music transformer and some examples of implementation. But maybe instead of showing this link, I think it should be available on the PDF itself. I want to quickly jump to questions and maybe show a different implementation of the transformer. Let me maybe, for the sake of the recording, go ahead and, move to a different share. Second. Okay, just sorry about that. So so a little bit more recent implementation of music transformer that actually uses multiple architecture is this musicautobot project. And yeah, if you can Google musicautobot, or actually it has its own online version, musicautobot.com. What is interesting about this specific implementation is that it allows multiple ways, or it implements several transformer models to generate music. So maybe in the larger view here, you can see that it has the idea of a priming sequence, or something that is used as an input to the transformer that then is being decoded into a new sequence. And it has several ways, so that I'll explain in a second how this melody, harmonized pitch, and rhythm are related to different models of the encoder. But the idea was that with the abundance of these transformer models, and each one of them having slightly different capacities or capabilities, we can actually use different architecture for different musical tasks. So if we want to use the idea of music, which comprises of maybe melody with chords, and this is kind of one of the assumptions that this work takes, is that music itself can be represented as a melody over these constructions of simultaneous notes that we call chords. And it doesn't really create multiple voices. It creates an accompaniment, or the harmony and the melody. So if we want to either generate melody from chords or generate harmonies from melodies, we use an encoder-decoder model. But if you want to do something like alternate the pitches or generate new rhythms, you can select a different one of these other tabs and basically be running a different model. So kind of to give an example here, I hope we can, so I can share the sound. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So with this priming sequence, if you're familiar with the piece, then you'll see how the continuations start capturing some aspects of the original encoding, but they're actually different from the the actual notes of that piece, which are here in the green grade kind of representation. So let's play this one quickly. Oh, sorry, let me start it. Oh, no, I think I'm restarting the training. Sorry, that wasn't a good idea, but. Okay, while it takes time, and maybe I'll let me switch and a little bit explain what the musicautobot does. And actually, it's documented pretty well in a series of blogs. So what he calls a multitask transformer, okay? Let's see, sorry, yeah. Is the idea that we can use several architectures of transformers. The sequence-to-sequence transformer that we saw before, there's another one which is called the transformer XL, which is very powerful and actually captures more memory or more length of the sequence. And there is BERT, which is mostly used for question answering or understanding of the language, less for translation. So so this is kind of the translation, this is generating, and this is for some other talks that I'll show in a second. So what we have is basically, let me see where we have the graphs. So this is the sequence to sequence, very much like the full transformer in the original paper. But the sequence is translating one language to another one. And in the case of music, it translates chords to melodies, or you can do the other way around. So what we have is an encoding of a sequence of representations of chords that is then being translated into decoding of a melody, where the training is basically done by shifting the melody. So this is where, you know, the first note is basically shifted here. It produces the second note shifted, and the second note is then expected to generate the third note, and the third note is producing the fourth, and so on. So this is exactly the same kind of a shifting that is being done in the RNN. So this is the sequence to sequence where we move from one aspect of the music to another aspect. So kind of we treat different aspects of music representation as different languages. In the so-called bird, the bird is most similar to the word-to-vec representation, where we basically are trying to recreate an output by looking into the other neighbors of that note. So the idea here of these silences or erasings basically is, can we look at the past and the future, basically the adjacent neighbors of the missing note, to guess what this note should be. So this is what Bird does by including these random masks in the transformer encoder model, and learns basically to fill in, if you want, missing notes, and by presenting multiple random kind of erasures like this that are meant to guess what the notes are, this is what Bird does. It does this masking, and for the music bot's idea was that this ability to actually understand every note by the context surrounding it, this could be a good way to create variations, remix, or create new melodies from an existing one. And the transformer is really kind of the shifting in time, where we have the inputs and the outputs. You know, the transformer XL actually has its own specific way to create extra long sequences. And this is done for the continuation task. So if we wanna look into some of the results of these productions, I think maybe instead of me running the example online, you know, in the blog, he actually has some nice examples of applying each one of these transformers for a different musical task. So this is the original Chainsmokers song. This is a peek into what the transformer created from the original Chainsmokers song. This is the original. This example, and I will go through the steps, is that actually it kind of recopies a lot of the existing or similar ideas. Now, in the blog, it describes, you know, the process. He couldn't apply this to the audio itself. He actually recreated the video. So there's this whole part of how he remakes the chorus of the Chainsmokers and finds the chords. But I mean, if we skip all that and assuming that somebody actually already has the song, So part one basically shows that he can recreate the song from the recording. Then he starts doing these remixes. So in the remix, basically what he takes is the MIDI notes and runs us through the autobot. So representation is here, and then he has two different ways to remix. And we said one is this token masking, okay? So the token masking is actually done by selecting the pitch aspect. And if you input that sequence and you select the pitch, basically you can see the results. And as I said, the red and blue are the notes that are predictions, and then the green and white are notes from the original melody. And you can see that it kind of creates a lot of changes. I mean, this is the seed, and here is the regeneration. Here is the output just from doing the melody changes. So, okay, sorry about that. So this is one way, basically by using the masking and using the pitch selection, which is using the bird technique. Another one is making a new melody, and this is a progression that takes the sequence, and I would let you kind of go and maybe play all of them and see what how it affects the music. So you can also do the keeping the chords, you create a different melody with the sequence to sequence model. I want to kind of conclude this presentation just with some thoughts or considerations about the nature of the music that transformers generate. They're able to capture, and this is actually there is the last link in the visualizing transformers actually shows how every point in the musical piece, if you run this, if you open this link, you can actually see a great visualization of how, that's the paper, sorry, I'm looking for, I'll have to recopy this to show it, but this visualization is actually a very powerful way of seeing how every moment in time, once we start learning a sequence, how every moment in time is actually being weighted by its similarity to all the previous moments in time, and start creating links. So these patterns that we start seeing that emerge here actually show us that every note in every of these are like the four voices of the Bach chorale, every note here is in some sense mostly influenced by specific notes in the past. And what these links create is basically a very strong influence of the past notes once we start generating. So if we do that, we actually create this kind of a suffix link type of graph that tends in some sense to recopy, or when we have a very strong influence of specific notes, specific elements in the past on what's going to happen in the next step, we kind of tend to use one of them and recopy. And by the nature of the sequential phrasing of music, we end up having kind of a recopying of a lot of musical elements from the past to the future. So the question is, how much of the generalizing or how much generalization it does versus how much it basically chops up music in different lengths and of course multiple features. But still, I mean, whatever it does this end to end and is able kind of to recreate, I think, pretty credible segments of music that then kind of jump a little bit reminiscent of other remixing techniques. Another difficulty is that usually trend, even though Transformer and Transformer XL can generate longer sequences, you're still kind of limited to the extent of memory that you can allocate. And transformers are quite notorious in terms of the amount of training they require. So for the project or for the ideas of using transformers, I think there are multiple ideas that you know could be of interest. Kind of generalizing the idea of chords and melodies, finding the you know the optimal transformer architecture for different musical tasks, and maybe finding some ways to address longer sequences. That's always you know a task that I think music is very special in the sense of being able to create a musical form, create like a story. How you do that? If we will have themes that kind of appear and reappear. After long delays. So I think there is still a lot of super interesting stuff to be done with these models. And that's kind of pretty much the, I'm not sure, actually, I think I was maybe not sharing. Yeah, I was sharing the screen, okay, so that's fine. Okay, yeah, so that's kind of the end of the Transformers presentation. And I think we can kind of stop the recording at this point.